Hello and welcome to Learn Yourself. Today we are going to solve some of the important questions from the chapter Is Matter Around Us Pure? This chapter is from CBSE Standard 9 syllabus. So these questions are from the page number 24. And first question is, how will you separate a mixture containing kerosene and petrol? The boiling point difference is more than 25 degrees centigrade and which are miscible liquids. Here, kerosene and petrol are miscible liquids. That means we cannot use a separating funnel, which we are using in immiscible liquids. Now, next step is we have to see that what is their boiling point difference. If boiling point difference is more than 25 degrees centigrade, then we are using distillation method to separate the miscible liquids. And if the boiling point difference is less than 25 degrees centigrade, which we have seen in the case of benzene and toluene, then we are using fractional distillation method. So I have given the link of this video in the description. If you have any doubt, you can go through those methods. So here, because of the boiling point difference is more than 25 degrees centigrade, we are using distillation method to separate miscible liquids, that is kerosene and petrol. Now, second is, name the separation technique. This question is important and you will definitely get one question and 2-3 MCQs and fill in the blank from this kind of question. Like, you have to guess which separation technique you will use to separate such kind of mixtures. So first, butter from curd. So it is centrifugation. Then second is salt from seawater. So here we can use evaporation technique also, but if we want a purest form of salt, then we are using crystallization. Then third, camphor from salt. Now here camphor is sublimable substance, and when it is mixed with non-sublimable substance, we can use sublimation technique. So there will be always a clue behind the mixture that which kind of technique you can use. Third question is, what type of mixtures are separated by crystallization? Now this question is opposite to this question. Here we have to guess the method, whereas here they have asked us which kind of mixture you will separate through this technique. So crystallization we are using to get a pure substance. From its impure form or mixture. Because through crystallization we are getting 99.9% pure substance, and generally all the laboratory substances we are getting through this crystallization method. So when any substance is mixed with its impurities or other kind of substance, then we are using crystallization to get the pure form of that substance. Moving towards our main exercise, that is from the page number 28. Now here we have to write that which separation technique we will use to separate this mixtures. So first is sodium chloride from its solution of water. So when NaCl is mixed in the water, we can use evaporation technique to separate salt from the water. So here, evaporation will be the technique which we are going to use for this. Then NH4Cl from mixture containing NaCl and NH4Cl. Now what is NH4Cl? NH4Cl is ammonium chloride. NaCl is sodium chloride, that is a salt. Now ammonium chloride is a sublimable substance. So when in a mixture one sublimable substance will be there and one common substance will be there, we are going to use technique sublimation. Then small pieces of metal in engine oil. So here the pieces will be big and engine oil is in the liquid form. So simple, we are going to use filtration for this mixture. Then different pigments from an extract of flower petal. So here whenever they are talking about dye or any color pigment, always we are going to use chromatography to separate this mixture. Then butter from curd. So it is centrifugation. Oil from water. Now whenever two liquids will be there, then you have to see that whether they are miscible or immiscible. If they are immiscible, that means they are not mixed with each other, they cannot mix with each other, then always the answer is separating funnel. And if the mixture liquid are miscible with each other, then you have to see their boiling point difference. If boiling point difference is less than 25 degrees centigrade, then we are doing fractional distillation. And if it is more than 25 degrees centigrade, then we are performing simple distillation. Now tea leaves from tea. So it is filtration. Iron beans from sand. So whenever iron is there as one of the substance in your mixture, then always you can use magnetization technique. Wheat grains from husk. Husk means the outer layer, outer cover of the wheat grain. That is very, very light. So here we are going to use a winnowing. Winnowing is a technique which is age-old technique, and each and every farmer who are growing wheat, they are using this to separate the husk from the wheat grain. So technique name is winnowing. Fine mud particles suspended in the water. Now if here they have written that big mud particles suspended in the water, then we would have done the sedimentation, that we will keep it aside for some time so that the big particles will settle down and then we will take out the upper layer of the water. But here they have said that fine mud particle, that means they are very, very minute. So here we are going to use centrifugation technique. So with the centrifugal force, those fine mud particle will settle down and our water will get clear. So here it is centrifugation. If the particles are big, then first sedimentation, afterwards you can take out the filtrate, the upper layer of the liquid, or afterwards you can also perform filtration. But here, since they have said that this particle are very minute and fine, we are going to perform centrifugation on this. Third question is based on the solubility. That here, all the substances whose solubility we are going to check at 283, 293, 313, 333 and 353 Kelvin temperature. And we can see here the data. And this data represents their solubility. That KNO3, that potassium nitrate's solubility is 21 at the temperature 283 Kelvin. And all this data is for 100 gram of water. So all the salts what we have taken is potassium nitrate, sodium chloride, potassium chloride and ammonium chloride. Now we have to answer this questions based on this data. First is, what mass of potassium nitrate required for the saturated solution when we are making 50 gram of water at 313 Kelvin? First we will see that 313 Kelvin potassium nitrate's solubility is this, that it is 62, and that too in 50 gram of water. Here this data represents at 100 gram of water. All these are saturated solution. So for 100 gram of water, if we are making a saturated solution of potassium nitrate at 313 degree Kelvin, then we require 62 gram of potassium nitrate. If we are making the amount of water half, then equally we require the half of the amount of potassium nitrate. So here at 100 gram of water, if we have taken 62 gram of potassium nitrate, then here 50 gram of water at the same temperature, we require the half of the amount of potassium nitrate. So here the amount of potassium nitrate will be half of this, that means 31. So what mass of potassium nitrate is required? Then it is 31. Now saturated solution of potassium chloride at 353 degree Kelvin. Now 353 degree Kelvin and KCl. So here this is the solubility of potassium chloride. So after that we are cooling it and we have to write the observation. So this at 353 degree Kelvin, if we are making a saturated solution of potassium chloride and after that we are cooling it, then we will observe the crystal of potassium chloride, or you can write there will be a crystallization. So crystallization of potassium chloride we can see after the cooling of the solution, but only if this cooling is gradually happening. If this cooling will be rapid, then we will get amorphous substance. Solubility of each salt at 293 degree Kelvin. So 293 Kelvin, the solubility of each salt is this. So with each salt we have to note this solubility, because this is a temperature 293 degree Kelvin. Then effect of change of temperature on solubility of salt. Here we have to mention each and every salt separately, because their increase in solubility is different according to their increase in temperature. Here for potassium nitrate, the solubility of potassium nitrate will increase along with the temperature. For sodium chloride, the solubility will remain constant till 313 degree Kelvin, and after that it will slightly increase. For potassium chloride, the solubility will remain constant till 293 degree Kelvin, and after that it will increase rapidly. For ammonium chloride, the solubility of salt will increase along with the temperature. So for KNO3 and NH4Cl you can write that in solubility will increase along with the temperature, but here you have to make separate sentence that they will remain constant till certain temperature, and after that this solubility will increase slightly, whereas here this solubility will increase rapidly. Whenever you are getting such kind of questions, then you have to analyze the data and you have to check that whether the solubility is increasing, whether the solubility increasing rapidly or after some time. So you can see the data that here 36, 36 and 36. So solubility is remain constant, and after this temperature it will increase, but it has not increased rapidly. That after 36 you cannot see here 56 or something like that. It's only reached till 37. So it will, you can write that it increased slightly. The next set of question. The fifth question says that we have to identify the following mixture, whether they are homogeneous or heterogeneous. So here soda water, wood, air, soil, vinegar and filtered tea has been given. So when we are segregating among heterogeneous and homogeneous mixture, what things we have to keep in mind, that if it is a homogeneous mixture, then the components are evenly mixed. You cannot make out that which component is lying where. Now heterogeneous mixture, the components are not evenly mixed in the mixture. So those mixtures are heterogeneous mixture. Now soda water. So soda water, if you will see, it is a homogeneous mixture because all the components are evenly mix. So it is homogeneous mixture. Then wood, it is heterogeneous. Then air. Here we are taking a pure air, we are not talking about polluted air. So here we will take a homogeneous mixture because all the gases are mixed evenly. Then soil, it is heterogeneous. Then vinegar. So vinegar, all the components are evenly mixed. So it is homogeneous. Then filtered tea, it is also homogeneous mixture. All the components are evenly mixed with each other. Now, next question, how would you confirm that a colorless liquid given to you is a pure water? Now, which physical property of water will tell us that this is a water? So that is a boiling point. So we have to boil that liquid, and if that liquid is boiled at 100 degrees Celsius, then it is a pure water. If any other colorless liquid will be there, then that liquid's boiling point will differ from 100 degrees Celsius. So we have to boil it and check it that whether it is boiling at 100 degrees Celsius or not. Even if it is not pure, then also its boiling point will slightly vary from 100 degrees Celsius. Next question is, identify pure substance. So here ice, milk, iron, hydrochloric acid, calcium oxide, mercury, brick, wood and air have been given. So here one by one we will take. So pure substance, ice. Ice is a pure substance. Then milk is not a pure substance. Then iron, hydrochloric acid and calcium oxide. They all three are pure substance. Mercury is a pure substance. Whereas brick, wood and air are not a pure substance. Then next, identify the solutions. So soil is not a solution. Sea water, yes, it is a solution. Air is a solution. Then coal is not a solution, whereas soda water is a solution. Moving towards our next set of question, that in this question we have to identify a solution which will show a Tyndall effect. Now, what is the meaning of Tyndall effect? Tyndall effect we can see in particularly colloidal solution. So, in this solution, we have to check that which solution type is a colloidal. So, salt solution is not a colloid. Milk is colloidal solution. Copper sulfate is not a colloidal solution, whereas starch is a colloidal solution. So, these two solution are colloidal solution and they will show a Tyndall effect. Now classify the following into element, compound and mixture. Now what is the element? Element is sodium, oxygen, hydrogen. All these are elements. What are the compounds? Compounds means H2O. When two or three elements are coming together and form one compound, that is a compound. They are combined by chemical bond. So these are the compound. Then calcium oxide, KCl, all these are compound. Now what are the mixtures? Salt plus water. So this is a mixture. Salt plus ammonium chloride, that is a mixture. When we are mixing physically, that means they are mixture. So now one by one we will see. Sodium, it is an element. Soil, it is a mixture. Sugar solution, so it is also a mixture. They are not combined chemically. Then silver, it's an element. Calcium carbonate, it is CaCO3. So it is calcium carbonate and this is a compound. Then tin, it is an element. Silicon is an element. Coal is a mixture. Then air is a mixture. Soap is a mixture. Then methane is a compound. It is CH4 methane. So it is a compound. Carbon dioxide is a compound. Then blood is a mixture. In our next question, we have to identify that following changes are whether chemical change or physical change. So first is growth of a plant. So it is a physical change where no new substance is forming. Rusting of iron is a chemical change where iron is converting into iron oxide. So this is a chemical change. Mixing of iron filling and sand. Here only they have said that it is a mixing. It is not a chemical compound. So this is a physical change. Then cooking of food. Yes, it is also a physical change where we are just heating the food and all the vegetable or whatever substance will be there will remain same. No new substance is forming. Digestion of food. This is a chemical change because from the food our digestive system are making a glucose. So a completely new substance is forming. So digestion of food is a chemical change. Freezing of water is just a state change, interconversion of state. So it is a physical change. Now burning of candle. Burning of candle is a chemical change when we are talking about a burning of wax. When we are talking about melting of wax, then it will be a physical change. So this is all about the exercise and some important questions from the chapter 2. Still you have any doubt regarding this topic, then you can post it in a comment box or you can write me directly at my email address. Don't forget to subscribe, learn yourself. There are many more important videos are coming up. So I'll see you in next video. Till then, keep learning, keep sharing.